నమస్కారం.
కేశవ స్వామి, నీங்க இப்போ உங்களை பத்தி ஒரு ரெண்டு நிமிஷம் நீங்க சொல்லுங்க, அதுக்கப்புறம் நான் என்னுடைய கேள்விகள்லாம் கேட்டுக்கிறேன். நீங்க யாரு, என்ன என்ன பண்றீங்கன்றது கொஞ்சம் சொல்லுங்க.
நான் கேஷவராவ் தாடிப்பத்ரி. ஐ ஒர்க்ட் ஏஸ் எ கம்ப்யூட்டர் கன்சல்டன்ட். ஐ டிட் மை எம்டெக் கம்ப்யூட்டர் சயின்ஸ் ஃப்ரம் ஐஐடி மட்ராஸ். அண்ட் ஆஃப்டர் தட் ஐ ஒர்க்ட் இன் வேரியஸ் ஆர்கனைசேஷன்ஸ். ஐ ஃபர்ஸ்ட் வென்ட் டு ஆஸ்திரேலியா, தென் ஐ கேம் டு யுனைடெட் ஸ்டேட்ஸ் ஆஃப் அமெரிக்கா. அண்ட் ஐ ஒர்க்ட் இன் யுனைடெட் ஸ்டேட்ஸ் ஆஃப் அமெரிக்கா ஃபார் ஓவர் 35 இயர்ஸ். அண்ட் நவ் ஃபார் த பாஸ்ட் 6-7 இயர்ஸ் ஐ ஆம் ரிட்டையர்ட். And I, for the past several years, I have been running Taadipatri Gurukula, where I teach my students various shastras as per Madhvacharya Siddhanta. And I have been initiated into the shastra by my father, who is not only my father, he is my guru also. And he is initiated by his father, my grandfather. My father is Taadipatri Venkata Subba Rao. And my grandfather is Taadipatri Hanumanta Rao, who is the disciple of the famous Sri Satyajnana Tirtha. And so the Guru Parampara is like that. And I am very particular about the accuracy of the Shastras, because the Shastras are Sarva Pramana. Once the Shastras come into picture, we cannot give our personal opinions. So the Shastras are of high importance for me. So in my teachings also, I emphasize that a lot to my disciples, and I encourage my disciples to ask questions, because if anything goes unanswered or unquestioned, that's not good. So everything has to be scrutinized and it has to be accurate. So I give a lot of importance for accuracy, and this is how I've been conducting my life. And fortunately, Puttige Matha has taken me as the Asthana Vidwan also. And I do whatever Bhagavan has ordered me to do. I do that as a service to Bhagavanta with humble feeling. And I always ready for any Shastra related questions. And it is of utmost importance in the current times that our Sanatana Dharma is protected from the hands of not only the external forces, but internally existing opposing forces also. We have to handle that. So that is what is very important in the current day, and I am very interested in doing that. Haresh Srinivasa.
Jai Shri Ram. For the benefit of viewers, we had discussed yesterday about the Sri Rama birth issue briefly, and Keshavji has kindly accepted to have a discussion online with me. And that is the reason why we are here. Keshavji, first let me start with a basic question on when was Ram born according to Valmiki Bhagavan, Valmiki Maharishi?
Yeah, according to Valmiki Bhagavan, he is, first thing that he emphasizes is, Valmiki says that whatever Ramayana he is writing is actually a kind of a condensed form of a Mula Ramayana, because there he refers Shatakoti Pravistaram. So 100 crore slokas Ramayana, there is a Mula Ramayana, which is not available today, of course. But Valmiki emphasizes that's the source for him. And in that, he also emphasizes that Sri Rama has all the lakshanas of Vishnu's avatara. And so Sri Rama is the Purna Avatara of Vishnu, and he exhibited all the powers that are there in Bhagavanta. He has exhibited all those powers. So Sri Rama is nothing but the Vishnu Avatara, Mula Avatara. And also he emphasizes another thing is that Sri Rama ruled for 11,000 years. That is according to Manushya Kalamana. Because when Avatareshu Naravatareshu Naravat Pravruttihi, when Bhagavanta takes avatara, he does everything according to the rules of this world. So the 11,000 years is the Manushyamana. There are three kinds of Kalamana that are there. One is Manushyamana, that we are all familiar with, human years. And the second one is Devamana, which is divine years, where 360 years of Manushyamana is 1 year of Devamana. So it's 360 times, that is the Devamana. And Brahmamana, we are all aware that 12 hours of Brahma is 1,000 Mahayugas. So the Brahmamana is, the slowest. So whatever Valmiki specified is according to Manushyamana years. Like Sri Rama going for 14 years forest, Vanavasa, that is Manushyamana. Same way, ruling 11,000 years is Manushyamana. That is according to the human scale of time scale. So that we have to realize.
So as per Valmiki, when was Rama born? As per Valmiki, when was Rama born? That was my question.
Oh, after Valmiki, Rama. Actually, Valmiki and Rama.
As per Valmiki Maharishi, in Valmiki Ramayana, he has said that Rama was born in such and such date, right?
Valmiki Ramayana, according to that, we have what is, now when I mentioned the Kalamana, there are 14 Manvantaras. In 14 Manvantaras, we are in Vaivasvata Manvantara. In Vaivasvata Manvantara, they are divided into Mahayugas. And we say, when we do the Sankalpa, we say Ashta Vimshati Kali Yuga. So this is 28th Mahayuga cycle we are in that. So Sri Rama was born in 24th. So it is clearly mentioned Chaturvimshati. So that is 24th Mahayuga in the Treta Yuga, almost at the end of the Treta Yuga. That is when Sri Rama was born. That is according to Valmiki Ramayana, and also according to Padma Purana, and also according to Vayu Purana, and according to Matsya Purana. So all these Puranas also confirm that Sri Rama was born in Chaturvimshati, that is 24th Mahayuga. In that Treta Yuga, that's when Sri Rama was born. So after Sri Rama was born, that Mahayuga completed, and then 25th, and then 26th Mahayuga, and 27th Mahayuga completed, and we are in 28th Mahayuga. In 28th Mahayuga, 3 Kruta Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga are complete, and we are in Kali Yuga. So this is how many years it has been passed. So the accurate calculations are all given, and according to those calculations, we are, crores of years are formed, and that much is we have to take into account. That's how long back Sri Rama was born.
But the current confusion that is there in the mind of people because of one Dushyant Sridhar, who has published a book called Ramayanam, Volume 1. I do not know what's going to happen in Volume 2. Volume 1, he claims that he is dated the birth rate of Sri Rama as 9th January 5114 BCE. Such accurate calculation. There are earlier people have also declared, one Mr. Bhatnagar has written a book which is saying that he was born on 10th January 5114 BCE. And there are other people who have said many things about the date of birth. What the current situation is doing is basically, it is coming from a group of Astikas who claim to be Vedic scholars. Dushyant Sridhar, in his social media, he himself puts this as Vedic scholars. I've never seen any Vedic scholar calling himself a Vedic scholar in my life. Nobody even wants to call them a scholar, first of all, because everybody wants to be a student. That is how Sanatana Dharma is. But a person who calls himself as a Vedic scholar, projects himself as a Vedic scholar in national media and social media, accurately says that on 9th January 5114 BCE, Rama was born. And I am basing this calculation based on Valmiki Ramayana itself. I am not somebody who's a scientist or anything. I am a religious fellow. I am actually doing lectures. Everybody listens to me. Thousands of lakhs of people are listening to me. 150 days a year, I go all over the world to give pravachans, one in the morning, one in the evening. And the rest of the time, I'm in India, going all over the place to give pravachans. And I am very popular in all news channels, news media. I am telling, along with myself, one other lady called Mrs. Jayasri Sarnathan, we both have done extensive research on this subject. And then we are concluding, for that matter, that it is 9th January 5114 BCE is the date of birth of Sri Rama, is what he says. What is your take on this?
Yeah, that is very unfortunate because there is no evidence for that at all. He is actually completely what we call swakapola kalpita. That is completely from his own brain. He has created that kind of a date specification. But cannot be done at all. He is completely wrong.
He is saying it is not swakapola kalpita. It is scientific brain that I have used to find it. It is not swakapola kalpita. All those people who are saying that it is for crores of years are all, he is calling short of them as idiots basically, because he is saying that he is using science to prove this. He has used computer software, which is called, I think it is called Planetarium of India or something, and he has used that. He has put the dates that Valmiki has said in Sri Ramayana as when Rama was born, the planets were all aligned in a certain ways, and I put it in the software. And the software told me, I believe software more than Valmiki Maharishi is what he says.
Yeah, so I'll explain that to you in a minute. What it is, yes, he has given a scientific explanation. He has given a calculation, but he's forgetting a simple fact. Agreed, Valmiki has specified certain parameters. Based on that scientific calculations, they have come up with astrological calculations. Fortunately, I am a mathematics student. I have studied astronomy. So I know the connection between astronomy and astrology. Any combination of astrological, astronomical parameters are given, that combination is a cyclic process. That means all those parameters can be on that day, no dispute, but it can be there on the previous cycle also. It can be there on the previous cycle also. It's a cyclic process. So the same parameters can also be present about 1.8 crore years ago. Also, it is quite possible that those scientific calculations are also valid then also. So his conclusion that, okay, I have whatever Valmiki specified, I have satisfied all those parameters according to the astrological or astronomical calculations. If he says that, agreed, those calculations will pertain to that date. But don't say that that pertains to only that day. It's a cyclic process. Time is a cyclic process. The same parameters are applicable for the previous cycle. The previous cycle, even millions and billions and trillions of years of ago also, those parameters can be satisfied. So it is scientifically wrong to say that those parameters are valid only on that particular day. Yes, they are valid on that particular day, but not only. It is valid on the previous cycle, many more cyclic moments or points are there when those parameters are valid. So that means his argument does not stand.
So what you're saying is, since the planets all revolve around the sun in an elliptical manner, in a circular manner,
yeah,
they will come back to the same positions, and that could have happened 7,000 years back. It could have happened probably another 7,000 years back and 7,000 years back, and you can keep going on backwards. My question then is, yes, if he uses a software, is there a limitation in the software to go back on time based on a particular algorithm to see whether the days have come earlier also?
Absolutely, because the software that, you know, fortunately I'm a computer programmer also, so I know how the software is. So the software, you can always program it in such a way, give me this point, whenever this whole combination is valid, at what earlier point, and you can put it into a loop, what you call a programming loop. There you specify, I want to go one iteration back, two iterations, we call it iterations. So they can go multiple iterations back, and it is quite possible programmatically to go back to as many iterations earlier as possible. For example, whatever date that they specified, it might be, say, another 25,000 years ago, another 25,000, whatever. So it is quite possible in the program to specify, give me 25th iteration back, 28th iteration back, or specify a range. I want between 1.7 crore and 1.8 crore years. In between the range, how many points I have, this same combination. It is very, very possible scientifically to do that.
Why would I then it beats me now. I'm surprised. So if somebody can go as many years, crores and crores of years backwards, why would somebody stop at 7,000 and say, then there's a problem? I can also give you the answer. The answer that they are telling now is that before 7,000 years, the earth was not even formed. There was no life in the earth. Because this is the earth, we know that the earth was formed from a particle bang. Big Bang theory tells that from a small particle, it burst big in a big way in a particular day, and then this slowly things started forming up. And 7,000 years back, only Ice Age was over. Then only everything started happening. Ganga was not there before. Yamuna was not there before. Nothing was on the earth before. Only 7,000 years back, Homo sapiens came in. That is, human beings came into being in this world. So it is not possible for anybody who would have lived 7,000 years back. So that is why I'm stopping at 7,000 years.
The argument, that argument can also be thrown out easily, because they say 7,000 years or whatever based on fossils. They call human fossils. They go for human fossils. We are not able to find human fossils which are million years old or billion years old. Human fossils we are not able to find. That is the argument they are presenting. There is a simple statement in English called, the absence of evidence is not an evidence of absence. Just because they did not find the fossils, it does not mean that they did not exist. You did not find. That's your limitation. So just because you did not find the fossils, don't say that it never existed. So absence of evidence is not an evidence of absence. Simple scientific principle. So they are forgetting that principle, and they are saying, okay, the earth, in fact, scientifically, they have this Big Bang theory. The earth has formed long back. And whatever they are saying, according to the fossils, is the evidence that they have collected. They have not collected evidence means the evidence might have been destroyed. Whatever might have happened, so many things. We talk about the Mahapralayas, Manvantara Pralayas. Manvantara Pralayas happens, things get destroyed. Probably all the human fossils might have been destroyed in the Manvantara Pralayas. So they're not finding the evidence is not evidence for non-existence. So that they have to realize that.
Now then it raises a bigger question. Now it is a more important, more serious question. Now what is it? I mean, the problem is, if you are saying Manvantara Pralaya came and then everything got destroyed, including human beings, and if you go to, just anybody can go to internet, Wikipedia, and then see, search for fossils and dinosaurs, they know that 200 billion years ago they found the remains of dinosaurs, etc. So life was existing even as per science even 2 crore years back also. So to say that there was no life existing before, to say that there is no life existing before 7,000 years is not right. Life was existing even as per science. But the problem is, when you say Pralaya comes and everything got destroyed, Ram Setu would have also got destroyed. How can Ram Setu stand now if there is a Pralaya? What we see now between India and Sri Lanka, even, I do not know whether NASA really claims that it is the Ram Setu, but everybody is in the world is saying that NASA has discovered, oh yeah, wonderful, ASI has discovered, oh wonderful, we have dated, carbon dating is done, excellent, we know for sure that 7,000 years back this Ram Setu existed because we did carbon dating, it is there even today, we want to protect it. I mean, if this Ram Setu, I also want to protect it, okay, so there is no doubt about it. But how can Ram Setu survive all these Manvantara Pralayas and Yuga Pralayas, etc., etc.?
Yeah, then the argument is another possible is Ram Setu, whatever we see that according to NASA, might have been a recreation by some devotees at, say, a few thousand years ago. Like 7,000 years ago, 8,000 years ago, the devotees might have created that, thinking about how Rama did it. So that's also possible. So we do not know. Whatever is not in our information basis, we cannot conclude. So the Ram Setu, whatever we are seeing, may not be the actual Ram Setu. It may be a model that have been created by some devotees. That's also possible.
Then, if you say so, then how are you very sure that it was crores and crores of years back? you are saying that scientists are not in a position to say because they don't know, absence of evidence is not, I mean, evidence is not acceptable as science. So, and you are saying that it could have been recreated by devotees later. Then how are you so sure that it is 1 crore year back or one or several crores year back?
Yes, the answer for that is there is what is called three kinds of pramana: pratyaksha, anumana, and agama. So when agama pramana, when something, it is what realm it is in. For example, when pratyaksha, if it is pratyaksha realm, suppose somebody says the fire burns, I put my hand, the fire burns. I don't need agama for that. Pratyaksha tells me. So in pratyaksha realm, pratyaksha rules. But when it comes to agama realm, the scriptural, there are the jnana yogis. They could see something that is beyond our pratyaksha. So we are believing that these great saints, they are able to perceive something that beyond our sight. Okay, this is what happened million years ago, billion years ago. Their jnana drushti gochara, they have documented it. In that realm, that is the ultimate pramana for us. So we have to see what we are considering. Our consideration should be in pratyaksha realm, pratyaksha rules. In agama realm, that is a scriptural realm, where the scriptures have been documented by the great jnana yogis, their perception, they could see something which is beyond our realm. There, we believe whatever they say is absolutely true. So we are going by the words that are been documented in agama. So their agama pramana rules, because it's agama, it's beyond pratyaksha. Pratyaksha atita vishaya, their agama is the pramana for us. So we cannot override agama with our pratyaksha. Our pratyaksha is limited. Whatever we have, our abilities are limited. Our documentation or our processing, our carbon dating, all these are within our limitations. But for jnana yogi, they go beyond those limitations. So their documentation, we give utmost importance for that. We cannot overrule or override whatever they have stated with our limited pratyaksha knowledge.
So that means in the Vaidika world, we have not only one source of knowledge, which is pratyaksha source, which is science is dependent on only pratyaksha and little bit of inference, anumana. Even inference, science world will not greatly accept. Unless otherwise they see it in a repeatable process, they won't accept it. So in science world, in the modern science world, or probably the life, the science that the current human race knows, there is a limitation on the source of knowledge, which is only pratyaksha pramana. And in the Vaidika world, we are saying we have three types of pramanas. One is the pratyaksha pramana, which everybody can see here and things. Anumana, which is the inference based on earlier knowledge, I am able to guess certain things. And the agama or Vedas, or the Shastras, or the Shabda, different words are said by different Sampradaya. These Vedas are the ultimate Pramana, which tells us about several things, including the existence of God, including the existence of Atma, and the relationship between Atma and Paramatma, and how the world was formed, etc., etc. Am I right if I say this?
Yes. And as you mentioned, of the three pramanas that we have taken, pratyaksha, anumana, and agama, pratyaksha pramana and agama pramana, agamaha nidoshaha shabdaha agamaha, whatever is flawless word, all those are agama pramana. These two are called swatantra pramanas. Pratyaksha and agama are swatantra pramanas. Anumana, anusrutya miyate. Anumana is not shushkatarka, because dry logic, naisha tarkena matirapaneya, as the Shruti says, tarka, if we do, we can argue anyway, black is white, white is black, we can do all kinds of tarka. That tarka is not the valid pramana. Anumana means anusrutya miyate. That means its ultimate source is either pratyaksha or agama. Using pratyaksha and agama, we do a anusrutya mana logic. So the inference should be based in pratyaksha and agama. That's why it's called not a swatantra pramana. Pratyaksha and agama are swatantra pramanas. And anumana becomes dependent pramana on pratyaksha and agama. So these three together have to be balanced properly, where we have to use pratyaksha, where we have to use anumana, where we have to use agama. We should be really, really clear about our concepts. That's why we cannot use in pratyaksha realm agama pramana. In agama realm, we cannot use pratyaksha. And this anumana kind of a bridges for that, where we have to use pratyaksha, where we have to use agama. this is guideline is comes from anuman or inference. So that we balance all these three, using all these three, we have to know where and how we have to conclude things. So all these three have to be balanced properly.
According to you, the research done by Dushyant Sridhar and Jayasri Sarnathan, are you saying that they are so confused between all these three?
Yes, they do not have a clear concept of these pramanas, which pramana has to be used, when and how, they are not clear. As we mentioned, people can claim anything. If wishes were to become horses, the beggars would ride. And he says, I am a Vedic scholar, I am a Vedic scholar. Anybody can come claim, I am a Vedic scholar. When I teach my students, I tell them, I am a student, you are a student. We are all co-students. That's how even our Shruti says, we all together have to do the studies. We have to go and learn things together. And this is how we have to develop humbleness. Vidya dadati vinayam, vinayad yati patratam. Without Vinaya, the Vidya does not get the Shobha. The moment we realize that I have known very little, then we will be going in a path of progress. Otherwise, like what happened to Svetaketu, he went for 12 years of education, he comes back, I know everything. And how Uddhalaka teaches him and tells him, no, whatever you know is very little. You don't even know how a tree comes out of a seed. You don't know that. There's so many things which are beyond you. So don't say that you know everything. So same way, people who ever claim, I am the scholar, I am a Vedic scholar, whatever say, I say, people have to believe, they are completely misguiding people. They are on the wrong track and they are keeping people on the wrong track. They have to realize, they have to become humble and realize that whatever Jnana Drushti Gochara things our ancient sages have given, that I have to accept as it is without questioning that. That humbleness they have to develop. Without that, it's very difficult.
Now they have, I mean, whatever you are saying, they are already refuting all the things. I'm reading a tweet from Mrs. Jayasri Sarnathan. She says, Hinduism is becoming like an Abrahamic faith. Bhagavan has been made a trader by promoting bhakti as a quick fix solution. She is actually blaming people like you, who are saying what is there in the book is what I will agree, I will not agree anything else. I mean, I'm not getting that feel, but this is the propaganda that is happening, that says that Hinduism has become like an Abrahamic religion, faith, and Bhagavan, you people have made your Bhagavan as a trader, and you are promoting bhakti, which is blind, and then you are saying no questions can be asked. I mean, I don't know. Are you doing that?
No, that is not true, because the Abrahamic religions, they say, oh, this is my God and this is the God for everybody. We don't say that. In our religion, we say Sarvashabda Vachyatva for Bhagavanta. He is in everything. He is himself not everything. So we see his presence in things. So bhakti, yes, bhakti is important. But bhakti does not say, don't question anything. Bhakti says, sure, go ahead and question. But after questioning, whatever answers are given, look at the answers and see the answers. So ours is not Abrahamic religion where don't question anything. No, we say question, because pariprashnena sevaya, that's what pariprashne. We say we encourage questioning. We want people to ask questions. So ours is not like Abrahamic religions. We encourage questions. We ask people, do question me, ask me questions. Like even Uddhalaka and Svetaketu. Svetaketu keeps asking questions. Uddhalaka keeps answering. We are not, don't question policy is not there in our philosophy. We encourage questioning. We want people to ask questions and we answer their questions. But we only in one case we say we don't ask questions, where Bhagavanta is Sarvashakta, means how is he Sarvashakta? What makes him Sarvashakta means look at this whole universe. If he has created this big universe, he is capable of doing anything. So we believe in the omnipotence, omnipresence, and omniscience of Paramatma. That is beyond our comprehension. That is the only thing that we don't question, but we question everything else. So ours is not at all like Abrahamic religion. We do encourage questioning. We don't say, oh, I say that, you believe it. No, that's not our policy.
give me a second. That very well answers my question and their question as well. I hope they will learn a thing or two from us. Instead of blaming us as saying that we are shunning down any questions. When I mean we, but like you rightly said, when whatever you found is in direct contradiction with whatever is said in the pramanas, that is the mukhya pramana that you saw, told about. Mukhya pramana takes precedence and not the alpa pramana, which is basically the pratyaksha pramana or whatever science is talking about. So we should not take the one that is there in our grasp, in our understanding, with the limited knowledge that we have. But we should take the mukhya pramana that is there in the Vedas and the Shastras and Itihasas and Upanishads. And we should, if our finding is not in line with that, we should probably start asking more questions on why it is not there. Why is it not working out? I think if I understand rightly from what you are saying, if only both Jayashri Saranathan and Dushyant Sridhar has said that for now, I have, with my limited knowledge, I have found that the date of birth of Rama is such and such, and I have a lot of unknowns in this, we don't have any problems, isn't it?
Yes. As you said, what we call Pramana Prabalya. As you said, whenever there's a contradiction between two things, which one is a prabala, which is stronger? We take the prabala pramana and the weaker one is taken away. So to determine which is prabala, which is not prabala, for example, in Rama's birth case. So they say they come up with an evidence that 8,000 years ago, 7,000 years ago. Then we come up with an evidence, he is 1.8 crore years ago. So between these two pramanas, there's a conflict. How do we resolve this conflict? Which is prabala? Now, the pramana can be retrofitted into ours because they said this cyclic, as I said, you know, 8,000 years ago, this combination has happened. And we are able to give them, hey, look, this is a cyclic process. It can happen this many years also, the previous cycle, the iterations is possible. So both the pramanas can be accurate. For example, your combinations and our 1.8 crore years ago, both can be retrofitted, both can be consistent where you go to the previous iterations. But if you take only your case, that means you are ignoring ours. You are killing one and you are, whereas we are not killing your pramana, we are taking yours. We are going to the prior iterations. So we are accepting yours, but you are saying only 8,000 years ago? No, it had the previous iteration go that way, the combinations, that means we satisfied your astrological calculations and also we satisfied the Agama Pramana. So here the conflict is resolved by connecting the two and by giving a completely consistent position. So that way, Prabala, both are supported. Whenever there is a supposed conflict where only one is, for example, Pratyaksha, for the example I give, suppose they find an Agama statement where they say fire does not burn, and then we put our hand, the fire burns. Hey, there's a conflict. Then we have to go, hey, look at the statement. Does it say fire does not burn? No. When it says, okay, if you have a divine Swarupa, then the fire does not burn. Something like that may be there. You are taking a wrong interpretation of the Agama Pramana and you are seeing the conflict. So whenever there's a conflict between two things, for example, an Agama Pramana and a Pratyaksha Pramana, the Agama Pramana or Pratyaksha Pramana, which one is correct means, see what is the realm. If the realm is Pratyaksha realm, then Agama Pramana has to be reinterpreted. Not that we don't drop it. We don't just, oh, this is wrong. Just drop the Agama Pramana. No. The Agama Pramana, we made a mistake. We misinterpreted it. Do the proper analysis, do the correct interpretation, then you have resolved it. Same way, if the realm is Agama and it is Pratyaksha Atita Vishaya, it is beyond Pratyaksha. You cannot determine with Pratyaksha. So Agama gets the Prabalya. There, you take Agama Pramana and Pratyaksha does not contradict it because it is a beyond the Pratyaksha concept. For example, Rama's birth, it is beyond our Pratyaksha. So it is beyond our Pratyaksha, so we are going for Agama Pramana. Then you are bringing a Pratyaksha with the astrological calculations. We are giving an answer for that. Go to the prior iterations. So that way the prior iteration tells you it is possible that this combination is multiple times, cyclic process, it happens. So we are answering your questions, then you answer our questions. You satisfy us, we are satisfying you. You satisfy us, then we'll go with you.
Then our pratyaksha pramana, agama pramana, and anumana pramana, the three pramanas that we accept as Sanatana Dharmis, is not accepted by the Western science. Western science don't say that, they don't trust Vedas basically. They don't believe Vedas exist because they are mostly Christian world basically, isn't it? So they're most of the things, they come from the Christian Bible, etc., etc., whatever they have seen. The Big Bang Theory, etc., etc., is only dated as common era or before Christ era, etc., etc. So they don't accept, and I'm kind of concerned if both Dushyant and Jayasri Sarnathan, who are actually blaming Vaidikas, are Abrahamic, are in fact Abrahamic, because they are the one who is not actually trusting the Pratyaksha Pramana or Agama Pramana, isn't it? If they don't accept the Agama Pramana and then say that Agama Pramanas are only imaginary, it is irrational, Rama living for 11,000 years, how is it possible? It's not possible at all. How can something which is built several crores of years back exist even today? I am seeing Setu, and I can believe the Setu, and I have dated it with my excellent tools. So I know for sure, if, and I don't want to listen to the pramanas that is coming from the itihasas and puranas. Even that also there, you know, Swamiji, basically what they are saying is, we will trust itihasas, because itihasas are written at the time of that is happening. Basically, it is history. It's a document. I do not know from how they can be, say, this rational. To say that itihasas are actual happening itself, if you bring in a rational mind, you can't accept it. Anyway, that they accept. And they are saying Puranas are hearsay. This is the exact same word that Nastikas are using in India and everywhere, saying that Puranas are all humbug, you know, it is all stories brought in by the Aryans who invaded India and then threw out all the natives, just like the Britishers went to America and then threw out their natives. We Dravidians in India were been overpowered by the Aryans who came from somewhere else through some canal, and that is the theory that those people who talk about those unproven theories, which even Ambedkar said that it is only fit to go into the dustbin. These people are echoing the same words. They're saying that Puranas are hearsay. They are just stories written by somebody. But I will accept itihasas. In itihasas, if there is something that I cannot comprehend with my mind, 11,000 years of Rama living in this world, it's not possible, so I won't accept. Crores of years back, the Ramayana happened. I cannot accept because I have dated carbon dating. I probably am going in circles, but I am in circles right now, you know. Unfortunately, with their so-called research, and then, I mean, like I said in the beginning, if this has come from a scientist, I will ignore him completely. Yeah. It's coming from somebody who's calling himself a Vedic scholar. Are you saying that this Vedic scholar is actually Abrahamic?
This is how it is. There are two kinds of enemies that we are having. One is this so-called pseudo-Vedic scholars. The second one is Indologists. There's another group called Indologists. They are also an external elements who think that they know about us more than us itself. That's why they come up with this Aryan invasion, Aryan immigration. Both are kind of conflicting. For example, look at them. They are saying Aryan invasion, Aryan immigration, whatever they call, both are two conflicting pramanas. Because you invade something, you are going as an enemy. You immigrate something, you are going as a refugee. So they are not even clear whether the Aryans came as invaders or came as refugees. Even that they are not clear. So they are so confused that Aryans came from somewhere outside, which is a completely a bogus theory, because that theory has so many issues. Actually, nowadays, that theory is slowly going away. That theory came, of course, quite a few years ago, but slowly is fading away because they realize that it is a flawed theory. Because how can Aryans come as invaders and also immigrants? How can the both is possible? First problem. Second problem, if they came as invaders or they migrated here, there should be original Aryans somewhere else. Only a small people will invade, right? Only small people will immigrate. What happened to all the Aryans that are outside? They suddenly disappear. They came from somewhere else to here, and all the Aryans outside, they have disappeared. Where did they disappear? And if Aryans came here and they wrote the Vedas, then the original Aryans who are all there outside somewhere, they must have written a similar to Veda somewhere there. Nobody with no Vedas were written outside. And the second thing is, they are giving a date for Veda. Rig Veda so many years ago, Yajur Veda so many years ago.
Yes.
Give us the proof for the Vedas originating at a particular point, because the Vedas are given from parampara. There is a Vedic parampara, and every person we know, like documented Vedic parampara, everybody said, I heard from prayer one. Shruti. That's why it's called Shruti. It is heard. I heard from my guru. My guru heard. And then we have Mantradashras who heard that. They are eternally presenting. So Vedas are considered as apavrusheya, that is unauthored and eternal work. So it is not like Abrahamic. Those Abrahamic religions are, they cannot blame us, because they are saying, oh, we don't believe in Vedas. Do you believe in your scriptures? Yeah, we believe in our scriptures. Why do you believe in your scriptures but not in Vedas? They say, oh, because our scriptures have been written by some supernatural person. Hey, how do you know that whoever wrote your scripture is a supernatural person? How do you know that that is an accurate thing? You are having multiple assumptions, whereas for us, we have no assumptions. We have a parampara where the Vedas are considered as apavrusheya, unauthored, eternally flowing text. That's why Vedas are reliable. And whatever contradictions you see in Vedas, we are able to resolve every single contradiction. Vedas do not have any contradictions. We can dissolve all the contradictions in Vedas. So Vedas are, if you don't accept Vedas, Vedas are the ones which tell us dharma, adharma. The dharma, adharma concept is presented by apavrusheya Vedas. And this apavrusheya Vedas form the basis for dharma and adharma. Whereas for you, if you don't accept Vedas, that means you are not accepting dharma and adharma itself. Dharma and adharma are needed for running this world. And Vedas give us the concept of, as you said, not only Paramatma, Jivatma, connection, everything. It also gives us what is dharma, what is adharma, which are very important for the survival of the society. So Vedas are needed for the society. They are eternally flowing, knowledge-based, and they are unauthored, they are apavrusheya. So we have to accept Vedas. There is no other go.
But my question is Dushyant Sridhar Abrahamic?
He has the characteristics of an Abrahamic. So he may claim, I'm not an Abrahamic because I don't believe in Bible. I don't believe in Quran. So I'm not Abrahamic. But he's exhibiting their own characteristics. Whatever I say is correct. You accept the way I give. I don't believe in Vedas. Like we call Pashanda Matas. Pashanda is like blindly refuting Vedas. Okay, you say you don't believe in Vedas. Tell us why. Tell us the reason why you don't believe in Vedas. Whatever reasons they give, we are able to answer all their questions. So Dushyant, he is acting like an Abrahamic person in aspect. I don't want to label him as Abrahamic, but he is exhibiting their characteristics, saying whatever I say, you have to accept. Whatever I say is absolutely true. Vedas, I don't believe. How can Rama rule for 11,000 years? That's not possible humanly. Then the Kalamana itself, there's a Devamana, there's a Brahmamana. In Brahmamana, we actually hear the story where a person goes to the Brahmaloka, he spends a few seconds, comes back here. Here, a lot of time has passed, elapsed. So this is how the different Kalamanas are there. When Ramadeva has come as Avatara, he doesn't have to confine to the human limitations. And even in those years, the rishis lived for thousands of years. We hear Vishwamitra being thousands of years tapas. How did he do tapas? We cannot reduce to, oh, he did 10,000 years tapas, we call his 10,000 days. We cannot do that because everywhere you cannot come up with your own Kalamana. There is a defined Kalamana that is there, and it is not only Ramadeva who has done 11,000 years, there are so many other great rishis who have lived for thousands of years. So it is possible for a human being who is in an exalted state for living for so many years. Even in these days, we hear people in Himalayas living for thousands of, so though we did not come across, at least we are aware that with extraordinary capabilities, the person can live for a very long time. It is possible.
Now, I'm shifting the topic from the research onto the effect of such research right now. So if somebody says that, and then if there's somebody shrinks the timeline to 7,000 years, and then somebody says that Rama was born only after 7,000 years because there was no world, there was no evolution which has happened, and Rama is a product of this evolutionary theory. What happens is that it seriously hits our fundamental belief that as per Madhva Sampradaya, it's Hari Sarvottama. Hari Sarvottama itself is actually being questioned, isn't it? Because if you are saying that he is a product of evolution and he cannot do anything on his own, the earth came on before him, are we right now questioning the Sarvottama aspect, the of Perumal himself? Are you able to understand where I am taking you? Is this where the
research is? Yes, I understand that. Yeah.
Where the research is taking us?
Yeah, questioning the all supremacy of Paramatma. He is actually questioning the all supremacy of Paramatma. He has to be confined by whatever rules are you are placing. He has to be within your rules. That's what he is saying. He is putting some rules on Rama and he has to confine to our rules. That's what he is saying. So, first of all, the very fact that he has taken so many avatars means for him, nothing bites him. He is beyond the rules. The rules do not bind him. He makes the rules and he knows what the rules mean. So he is the one who is making the rules. And if he is bound by his own rules, how can he make the rules? He has to be beyond the rules. If someone makes the rules means the person has to be above that, then he can, of course, he can come back and behave according to his own rules. But for a person to make the rules, he should have the extraordinary capability. If Sri Rama has to be limited by whatever parameters he puts, then that means he's saying, I don't accept the supremacy of Paramatma. So that means actually he is almost behaving like, you know, a kind of an, he doesn't realize it, but he's acting like an Astika. In the sense, he says, I don't believe in the all supremacy of Sri Rama. If he says that, then that's a problem.
You are saying that he did not realize it, but having written a book, and then having taken it to multiple countries and then sold several copies of it, I'm not sure if he is not realizing what he's doing. Because like I said, he claims himself as a Vedic scholar. The other person, Jayasiri Saranathan, may do that because she is, she is an ordinary citizen and she is not very well versed in these things. And so I can understand that. But to endorse the work of Jayasiri Saranathan and then say this is how it has happened, not once, for the past 2-3 years, I'm seeing Dushyant Sridhar limiting the life of Rama to 7,000 years and then fitting him into the narrative set by the Abrahamic religion, saying that the earth was only formed so and so date and life came only on so and so date. So they are actually trying to confine it. This is basically a Nastikavad in my opinion. It is nothing but Nastikavad, isn't it?
Yeah, the thing is, I have to, like, you know, either you or me or someone has to have one-on-one conversation with him and ask him a specific question. Do you believe in All Supreme God or not? Do you believe in Paramatma? So we have to ask him question and corner him, because now what is happening is, he is giving some, you know, he has written a book, he is giving lectures, he is propagating all over his principles, but nobody is questioning him. He is going unquestioned. So we have to question him one-on-one, saying, what is your position on this? What is your position on this? If we ask him specific questions and get specific answers from him, then we can really corner him and bring out where he is wrong. So we need to get that opportunity to question him.
Right now I am actually looking on my screen on a side where says there is a Twitter ID called Tamil Labs 2.0. okay, and then in that they have published a book of Cho Ramaswamy, who's a famous person in Tamil Nadu. And then he has written a book, and in the preface of the book he is quoting a sloka, Agnyaha Sukamaradhyaha Sukadharamaradhyate Viseshagnyaha Jnana Lava
Durvidagdam Brahma Api Naram Naranjayati.
This is actually, the meaning of it is basically saying, those who don't know, they know little or more dangerous, isn't it?
Yes.
They are quoting this, and then they are concluding that. And Ms. Jayasri Swaranaran says, she takes the same thing and then says, word is in the thread, but the one who knows little but thinks he knows everything, even Brahma cannot please. And then she blames you and me and all the Astikas. We know little and we know we blame everybody, is what she says, while we are saying that she is knowing little. Who is correct? A common man is so confused now.
Yes. This is the word that is used in that Shubhashita, Jnana Lava Durvidagdha. The word Jnana Lava Durvidagdha actually describes the person completely. The word means Jnana Lava. That means he has a very little knowledge, but Durvidagdha, he thinks that he knows everything. So the person who knows a very little and thinks that he knows a lot is a Jnana Lava Durvidagdha. Such a person, Brahma Api Naram Naranjayati. Even Brahma cannot convince him, because he knows very little, but he thinks of everything. So whatever you tell him, I know it, he says. And he won't accept whatever we say. And that person, that kind of a person, even Brahma cannot convince him, because he always comes up with, I know it. And that is the problem.
But on the other hand, we say we don't know. Certain things we don't know is what we say. We are never saying that we know everything. We accept the fact that our knowledge is limited, our sensory organs are limited, and that is why we take pratyaksha, agama pramana as the most important pramana, and then we say we are limited and we accept it. So that Subhashita doesn't actually point to us, because we are accepting, isn't it?
No, not really. This is how it is. The Jnana Lava Durvidagdha does not mean the person will never say, I don't know. Yes, he will say, I don't know, when it comes to his support. But when it is opposing him, then he says, I know. So it is selectively, I don't know, I know. It is not a universal, I don't know. Because in our Shastras, it says, God, about God, I don't know anything about. He who thinks that he knows God doesn't know God. He who thinks that I cannot know God completely knows about God a little. That is how it is defined. So for sure, they say, I don't know, they say sometimes. But when it comes to convenient things, then they say, oh, I know this. Because the astrological calculations, hey, we know this. So they come to certain conclusions, they say they know. Certain things they don't know. They do say certain things they don't know. But it is a selective, I don't know, selective, I know. We have to really corner them where you say you don't know, where you say if there is a conflict between these two or not. That we have to really analyze and put them on spot and expose them. Hey, this is where your issue is. That is how we have to do. Basically, so far, put them on a spot, put them in a corner and do this.
So far, in my limited knowledge, they have never said, I don't know in this aspect. They are very sure. So they are saying, I know that you, but you do not know. Anyway, we will leave it there and then come back to the effects of this research. They are claiming that they are doing this research to convince the current generation is having a scientific brain, which is having a rational brain, which is wanting to understand the reasoning behind any statement that we make. And it's and in that way, when I convince them, I can tell them that Ramayana exists, and then imbibe the faith in them. But in my opinion, the moment you question certain things, like whether Rama existed 11,000 years, the same kid to whom you are trying to rationally prove things in the with so-called science, you can't prove that Krishna lifted Govardhanagiri with a little finger. You can't prove that Ravana flew, you had a Pushpaka Vimana. You can't prove even Vasishta exists or Valmiki existed, because they are all way beyond our comprehension. You can't prove how Vedas existed. You can't prove the Apaurusheya and Anadi characteristic of Vedas. You can't prove the existence of God itself, because you can't see, and you can't prove the Sarvottama of God also. And you are actually putting in doshas in God as well, while saying so things. So by actually trying to say that you are actually convincing people, be giving us reasoning for a particular aspect, date of birth only, are you not actually putting everything else in question? And the same kid is going to answer several other questions, and how are you going to answer those questions? Unfortunately, they don't have an answer, but we have an answer for everything. Not we means not us. Our rishis have given it to us, and then we are repeating the same thing.
Yeah, they are claiming they are scientific, but look, the science is a great tool. The science always has a power, you know, the power to explain things, whatever is within its limits. But science also accepts this is beyond me. The science is so frank, so open. Whatever is not available for science, it says, it stops. It doesn't say, it doesn't exist. Science will never say something is not true. It says, this is not within my limits. This is within. Even a quantum theory, if you take the quantum theory, it explains, okay, this is probable, this is not probable. It always goes what is within its limits. Science will never say something that is beyond science does not exist. For example, our Atma, look at that. Scientifically, you can prove our body working, functioning, brain waves, everything you can do. But can you prove scientifically that the Atma exists, the soul exists? Can you prove scientifically? It's impossible. And science accepts this. Yes, I don't know anything about the Atma, the soul. I don't know anything about it. Science sits back. So science is a frank and very open tool. It accepts that there are certain aspects which are beyond science. Science and pratyaksha are kind of a synonymous, in the sense science deals with all pratyaksha realm. And whatever is beyond pratyaksha, science says, I don't refute it, I don't know about it. Science is very frank in saying that is beyond me, that is not pratyaksha realm. And they say, whatever is beyond pratyaksha, I don't accept. If they say that, then they should not accept that Atma exists, because Atma is beyond pratyaksha. So that means they are refuting the Atma itself. There are so many things that are beyond pratyaksha. How do you prove the existence of Atma?
So what they are doing is they are even confusing everybody more by saying that I am doing something scientifically, isn't it? Isn't it a danger in the current world?
Yes.
Where there's a lot of issues, unless otherwise we have the benefit of the scriptures, especially Sanatana Dharma scriptures, it is not possible for us to imbibe any good qualities, because right now it's become so hard to find good qualities in people. You know, it's very, very difficult. The daya. What do you mean by daya? How do you say what daya is? Unless otherwise you know what Rama and what Rama, how he showed daya, it is not possible. So we are actually, I will try to conclude this for now. We will have another discussion later.
Sure, yeah, it's a very nice point you brought. And Bhagavad Gita does that. Daivi Asuri Sampat Vibhaga Yoga. What is Daivi Sampat? What is Asuri Sampat? It beautifully analyzes that.
So, I mean, in my concern throughout the past 10, 5, 15 days is only because it's not about the date. We can ignore the date. Doesn't matter to us. Even the date is wrong. Even the date is wrong, because Valmiki says Rama was born in Chaitra Mas. January Masa is not Chaitra Masa in any calendar for that matter. So right there it is gone. So 9th January can never be there. It has to be somewhere in the April, May. That is the time where Chaitra Masa comes in. So right there it is gone. But the problem is when half-baked information or half-truths are given, it is even more dangerous than complete lie is what they say, isn't it? So the complete lie has been floated by Nastikas. Half-truths are being floated by the Charuakas, the Astika Nastikas, who are neither here nor there. They are like a fish in the water, just escape in whatever you say. And it actually confuses the whole thing. I will just ask one final question. Current world, many people, including Jaggi Vasudev is saying that we are actually moving towards Dwapara Yuga. I don't know from where he says that. When the Shastras are all saying that it's Krita, Treta, Dwapara, Kali, Jaggi Vasudev says it's from Kali you have to go, you are actually entering into Dwapara Yuga. Probably he will then go to Treta Yuga, and then probably he will then go to Krita Yuga, and then probably he will come back to Kali Yuga. This is his theory, okay? Concern is that people have taken it for granted that any scripture that is in Sanatana Dharma is open to criticism by anybody or open to interpretation by anybody as they please. And then, the law gives them right to propagate their own religion. But they don't use the scriptures that they want to create. I appreciate Christians and Muslims because they have their own scriptures. They are not using our scriptures at all. They have their own scriptures and they have their own leaders, the gurus, etc., etc. They have their own. But here, people like Dushyant, people like Jaggi Vasudev, and so on and so forth, these people, they are using our own scriptures, misinterpreting it, and then saying, this is how you should see things. What is your take on that, Swamiji?
Yeah, very, very interesting thing, because the problem is this. They do not have proper guru to guide them. They take in the scriptures. They are acting like a small child. You give a knife to a small child, it hurts itself. It doesn't know how to use the knife. So for them, the scriptures are given, they don't know how to use them also, because they are not even trained in that. So when they talk, you know, with all due respect to Jaggi Vasudev, he is a very smart person, but his exposure to scriptures so poor that he doesn't know what is right, what is wrong in scriptures. Because the unfortunate thing for us, our scriptures, lot of people have meddled with them, especially that Bhavishya Purana, Bhavishyottara Purana, the people have mutilated it so much that 80% of it is really messed up and only 20% is left out. Fortunately, some good ones like Bhagavata, 90% is good, 10% is misinterpreted. Lot of interpolations have come, lot of people have meddled with that. That is one unfortunate thing. The second unfortunate thing, these translators like Neo-Vedantins. These Neo-Vedantins, they have come and they have imagined their own things, written articles on the scriptures with their own interpretations. And the people like Jaggi Vasudev and others who do not have proper exposure and training in scriptures, but have wonderful skill in talking in such a sweet language and making people very happy with their presentation, they're able to misguide them with their beauty. That's why they call Charvaka. The word Charvaka is a very interesting word. Char means beautiful. Vaka is speech. Their speech is very beautiful, but it is on a wrong direction. So the Charvakas, the beautiful speakers, have come and taken these powerful tools of our scriptures and put them in a wrong way and confusing people tremendously. The people who blindly follow them, millions of followers, are completely put into confusion because of their wrong interpretation. For example, Jaggi Vasudev, in one of his speeches, he mentioned that how Sri Krishna is so desperate to marry Radha and how he becomes, his mother and father find it very difficult to convince Sri Krishna, and they think the only way to do it is to divert his mind. So they put him into Sandipani's educational system so that he can forget about Radha. This is how he's talking about. He's completely destroying our scriptures. So, so many things like that. So that very dangerous thing that is happening, our scriptures are a powerful thing that is there. They have to be handled very sensitively, properly, and accurately. And people have to see them with the right perspective. Otherwise, it's really in a dangerous hand. So we have to really preserve them, protect them. That's very important now.
The only way for the youngsters, the younger generation and the coming generation is to ensure that they stick to the traditional way of learning by approaching a guru who has got a parampara. It is very important. The word parampara is very, very, very important. From where did you get your knowledge is so very important. And unless otherwise you know, you can say I sat under the Bodhi tree and got enlightened like Buddha. You can say so. But we know what Buddha did to Vedas. And thanks to the Mahacharyas who were there in the past, Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya and Madhvacharya, Buddhists were put in their place basically, who actually said Vedas don't exist. So today, different forms, I mean, like I said, I wanted to say is basically these kind of Charvakas were there all the year, all these times. They are not new to us. They were there in the past and they were tackled by us and the people are guided properly from going and then falling in a dungeon basically. So the only way, if I understand from what you're saying, is to for the youngsters to approach these respective Sampradaya Acharyas. Madhvas should go to the Madhvacharyas, Vaishnavas should go to Vaishnava Acharyas, Shaivas should go to Shivacharyas, and Advaitis should go to Advaiti Acharyas, etc., etc., and learn from them. Because there is a lineage, there is a clear-cut understanding of who, from whom they learn. There is a thread,
yes,
up until anybody, you know, anybody. It can be any sampradaya for that matter, but there can be a thread. So the ultimate, the key point for the youngsters to take away from this, if I correct me if I'm wrong, to ensure that they don't believe anybody who says that I know, find out the acharyan and the pracharyan and the lineage from which they have come, even if it is Dushyant. That is what I did, sir. First thing that I did, Swamiji, is basically to call the acharyan of Dushyant Sridhar, Swami Karnakara Acharya, and then ask him whether he is accepting this.
Yes.
Because he has learned everything from his acharyan only. Swami Karnakara Acharya very categorically said that no, I don't agree. We are all Vaidikas. We only go by Vaidika Pramanas. We don't go by science, etc., etc. Of course, being a Vaidik, he is always saying, like Swamiji is also saying, I am half half Laukika basically right now. So I may be crude in whatever saying, but Swamiji rightly, correctly puts that you have with due respect the words, the diplomatic words that you have to put in certain places. Swamiji Karnakara Acharya has also said what Dushyant Sridhar has said is wrong. So unless otherwise you approach the acharya and then check if they are right, it's not going to be they are actually in bad hands basically, and they are actually going to be facing serious issues in their life, in this life as well, in the afterlife as well, is what I'm saying. If I said anything
wrong, that's absolutely correct. That's why it's a Brahmanta Guravah Sakshad Ishtam Daivam Shiyapatihi Acharyaha Srimad Acharyaha Santu Janmani Janmani. We all have to depend our Acharya Parampara, and because that is a disciplined study. Without discipline, the study becomes haphazard. It can become a dangerous. Half knowledge is dangerous. So that's why if half knowledge is dangerous, means we should have a disciplined study with proper parampara. That way we know that whatever we are studying is in proper disciplined manner it is going on. That is very, very essential. Yes, that is very important.
So when there is a deviation from the traditional learnings, the right place to go is to go to your acharya and then seek their clarification. Right place is to go to traditional scholars to find out what their opinion is, and then be open to correct yourself if you may be wrong. I mean, what I am saying is today is not the right thing. I never claim that I am right. So if you are wrong, correct it. But the correction should happen in the Sanatana Dharma Parampara way and not on a modern so-called corporate guru style, which is convenient to people.
Yes.
Convenience is always a danger for perfection. You know? People try to cut corners and then they land up in a bottomless pit, where they can never be rescued. Perumal Sriman Narayana actually is in tears when such things happens. You know, that is what our Shastra says. When they lose an Atma, and then in a bottomless pit, which is in a downward spiral, the first person who is concerned so much is Paramatma, is what our scripture says.
Yes.
And I thank you so much for your time and your sharing your knowledge. I hope people will be able to understand. Before I conclude, Swamiji, one other major accusation on me, I will have to point out. I am a Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya person. Right now, people are saying only Sri Vaishnavas are actually targeting Dushyant Sridhar because Sri Vaishnavas are thinking that they are all super duper knowledgeable. You are not a Sri Vaishnava, you are a Madhva Sampradaya person. Swamiji, what is that you are saying? Are you seeing me as a person who is targeting Dushyant Sridhar?
No, not at all. Because the question is, the Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya and Madhva Sampradaya, they're very close because both of them accept in the supremacy of Narayana. Both of them accept in the Lakshmi being the very next to Narayana all the time. So there's a lot of commonness in both of us. So the both of Sampradayas are going in the same direction. There may be minor differences which are okay, which can be, we can always talk about it, discuss that. But the major principle still the same. And both, actually, even I'll include Advaitins, though they have their own understanding of scriptures, we had a lot of debates about that. But still, the value that is to be given to the scriptures, they also give value for the scriptures. All three sampradayas, they give utmost value to the Vedas. All of us, we accept Vedas as Paramapramana. And all of us, we do accept the Pratyaksha Pramana also we accept. So the three pramanas, pratyaksha, anumana, agama. Of course, there are some people who add other pramanas, which are all can be subsumed into anumana pramana. Majorly, these three pramanas, actually all three schools accept. So we have a lot of commonness is also there. And the ones who are actually claim that they belong to these sampradayas, but go against these sampradayas itself are like internal enemies. So that is the problem we are facing. So we should
am I targeting Dushyant?
No, you are going in the right direction in fighting the internal enemies. Because as people like Dushyant who are misinterpreting the scriptures, you are putting a war against them. It is not war against them. Your intention is to go against those who go against scriptures. That's all you are opposing. So your intentions are good and your approach is good. And that's why I came to give full support to whatever you are doing. Because, yes, our goal is to prevent people from misinterpreting our scriptures. That is our goal. So certainly I appreciate what all you are doing. And it's really a great service. And I really commend you for that.
Thank you very much, Swamiji. And we will conclude it at this moment. We will have another discussion. I want as many people to talk to me. I will take this opportunity to tell everybody that I am open to discuss with anybody and everybody on this matter. And I want to talk to people instead of just sharing knowledge in Twitter, which is very limited. Face-to-face conversation, an open conversation unfortunately, Jayasri Saradhan was supposed to come with me on a debate on a channel, Tamil channel, Pesu Tamara Pesu, but she backed off, citing some other reasons. I'm still open to have any discussion with anybody, be it Dushyant, be it Jayasri Saranathan. More than me, in the past 5 days, 6 days, several acharyas, several pandits, several upanyasakas have come and then shared their knowledge, shared their views, and then are unanimous in their in rejecting the current theory. So if anybody, any group, anywhere in the world want to have a discussion with me on this, I am ready and I am open to do this. I wish Swamiji also creates another group and then have a discussion. So normal people who are not very well versed in scriptures, who are actually wanting to learn, can learn from Swamiji and others, and then we can have a group discussion on what we feel. There can be pluses and minuses. People can support or oppose. Support me or oppose me, support Dushyant or oppose Dushyant, doesn't matter. But let it be a civilized, open discussion where we keep our points out in the open for the public, which will be a record for the generations to come. So whenever they are confronted, they know where to go. They know that there is something else where people discuss enough about it. Unfortunately, we don't have the wherewithal. We don't have the powers to bring in national media as Dushyant Sridhar does. You know, he is very smart in those areas where he can go to any prime channel in India, ask for a 30-minute interview of him. We know how much it costs to have a 30-minute interview. Not normal people won't know. That they think that it is an interview, but it is all paid interviews. We know that. We don't have that capacity. We don't have the, but thanks to internet, thanks to applications, video conferencing applications like this, from anywhere in the world, we can all sit together, and then thanks to YouTube and thanks to Facebook, we can share this discussion to enough number of people so they can judge whether we are right or we are wrong, whether somebody is right or somebody is wrong, and then know the right path to salvation. At the end of the day, moksha is what is important. The birth date of Rama is not going to give you moksha. Rama was born in A day or B day, doesn't matter. What matters is what Rama did. He came here to teach us how to live as a human being. What are all the qualities that you should acquire so you can become a liberated soul, you can go to Vaikuntha Vasi, you can get moksha. I conclude this at this point. Thanks to you. Jai Shri Ram.
Thank you, Jay.
Came out very well, I think.
Shri Ram, Shri Ram.